I don't envy you your assignment tonight, and I'm sure the feeling is mutual. I have a statement here which I want to make in behalf of Dr. Gilruth.
January 27th, 1967. With these faltering words, NASA spokesman Paul Haney briefs the press on the sudden and stunning death in action of the entire crew training to make the first manned Apollo spaceflight. Gus Grissom, 40, veteran of both Mercury and Gemini. Ed White, 36, America's first spacewalker. Lieutenant Commander Roger Chaffee, 31, a rookie who had yet to win his space wing.
Our first walk in space. Roger Chaffee, one of the younger pilots.
Other American astronauts have died in plane and car accidents. These three are the first to be killed on the job, in circumstances filled with tragic ironies. Ready for all the risks of moonflight, they die in a stationary ground test. Trained to respond automatically to 100 emergencies, they're trapped by a fire they have no adequate means to fight or escape. Superb examples of the can-do temperament, they're left at the last with no choice but to perish in the furnace of a pressurized, pure oxygen atmosphere that had worked perfectly on 16 Mercury and Gemini flights before. The activities of Friday, January 27th for Apollo Saturn Mission 204 were to constitute the third ground test by this prime crew of an entirely new spacecraft. It's regarded as routine by the public, and NASA itself has classified the test as non-hazardous. But, in the words of Dr. Joseph Shea, then Apollo spacecraft program manager,
"We were frankly worried about the state of euphoria that was beginning to set in on the public mind about how easy this particular thing was. You light a match at the pad, the bird goes up, everything's great. Guys come back down again, you've got some heroes. That's the fun part of it, though. We were hoping to impress on people that there were mortals working on the program."
The fact is that no less than 20,000 bugs have appeared in the Apollo spacecraft during the 5 years of its development. The dangers of a pure oxygen atmosphere have been argued and re-argued, and finally traded off against the weight problem and danger of bends that are the price of a normal Earth-like mixture of nitrogen with oxygen. The test started at 7:55 a.m. on launch pad 34. At 1 p.m., the three-man crew entered the spacecraft, and for almost 5 hours now, they've been perched 22 stories high on an unfueled Saturn 1B rocket, an earlier and smaller version of the Saturn V moon rocket. Wrapped around the rocket and its spacecraft is the entire pre-launch structure of steel scaffolding. In 10 minutes, there's to be a change to a plugs-out condition. In other words, the crew is to simulate flying on its own, using only the internal power of the spacecraft itself. But then a hold is called because of a communications problem. Technicians work to clear it up, and the crew tests its microphone. Gus Grissom, as command pilot, lies supine on the left-hand contour couch under the flight control panel.
Roger, senior pilot, counting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, senior pilot.
Ed White, as senior pilot navigator, has the middle couch.
Pilot, hadn't caught you yet. How's this? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Roger Chaffee, as pilot, lies on the right. Suddenly, at 6:31 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, Apollo Control is startled by a series of short, desperate, unclear messages indicating a fire inside the spacecraft. These transmissions last a shade more than 17 seconds, and then the pilots are overcome. To have opened the escape hatch as then designed and gotten out alive would have taken 90 seconds. Desperately, the safety crew outside try to wrench open the hatch. They succeed only in burning their own hands and are overcome by smoke poisoning.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread.
At each funeral, there is the special honor accorded to airmen. A V-shaped formation of jets fly by, with one plane missing. Within 24 hours, an investigating commission is appointed, designated as the Apollo 204 Review Board. It includes astronaut Frank Borman, veteran of Gemini 7, slated for a later Apollo flight himself.
There's no question about it. We all overlooked the fact that it was a coffin. And I would have flown it gladly. I think that the outlook of the people that remain is very similar to the outlook of anybody in the Air Force or anyone that's been involved in hazardous duty. There's a certain defense mechanism where you firmly believe that it's never happened to you, and when it happens to somebody else, you just press on.
The triple tragedy suddenly pulls aside the mask of cool business-like objectivity from the pilots, managers, scientists, and technicians who've been manning the space program for a decade. The following Monday, Joe Shea tells his Apollo people in Houston,
if ever we needed a rededication for this program and a re-pointing out of the importance of little things and a re-pointing out of the attention to detail that's required, then this event brings it home. The problem is that we just weren't quite good enough, but we will be the next time we come up.
This investigation gets underway. In the words of Colonel Borman,
the only instruction that I ever received during the entire 4 months we were working on the accident regarding comment, public comment, or so on, was when we went before Congress, and that was three words, tell the truth.
The board is very concerned.
April 9th, 1967, the board reports, in words like steel-tipped arrows, problems of program management or relationships between NASA centers and with a contractor have led in some cases to insufficient response to changing program requirements. Deficiencies in design, workmanship, and quality control. The command module contained many types and classes of combustible material. Adequate safety precautions were neither established nor observed for this test. The fire was most probably brought about by some minor malfunction of equipment or wire insulation. Werner von Braun, who has directed the creation of the first rocket that put an American in space, and now the Saturn V that will take us to the moon.
Now, ever since the accident, a million words were spoken and a million words were written. Not all of them competent. We know that we have taken on a very challenging program, or as Bill Allen, the president of Boeing, said that night, this reminds one again that we are not in the business of making shoes. It is our job as engineers to make sure that these risks that are unavoidable are reduced to the bare minimum. Three brave men lost their lives for space flight, and I think we owe it to Gus Grissom, to Ed White, and to Roger Chaffee, that we go back and put our program back into gear where it belongs.
Measures are taken to correct the deficiencies. Flammable materials are removed. The hatch is redesigned for quick escape. The oxygen problem is compromised by using a mixture with nitrogen on the ground and pure oxygen only in space. Alan Shepard, whose public voice until now has sounded like a printed page, reveals the depth of his own emotions at a dinner marking the sixth anniversary of his historic flight as our first man in space.
All of us here tonight jointly share the responsibilities for the human frailties which are now so apparent, and for the insidious combination of materials and equipment which was so devastating in their behavior. We also jointly share the responsibility for future prevention of similar circumstances. The time for recrimination is over. There is much to be done, morale is high. Let's get on with the job.
7 years from the date the North American Aviation received the contract, and 40 weeks after unmanned test of Saturn V, the three-stage Goliath that is eventually to pitch the Apollo spacecraft to the moon.
James C., how are you?
It's a good flight.
ACOM, good flight?
Yeah.
Booster good?
Go at this time.
Go all the way, booster.
As the sound waves reach the press site, 3.1 miles from the pad.
Advantage shape. Terrific, the building's shaking. This big glass window is shaking. Now we're holding it with our hands. Look at that rocket go!
That was Walter Cronkite, usually a calm observer of world crises, as the commotion of Saturn V's blastoff threatens to shake apart the booth where Cronkite is reporting the launch for CBS. The Apollo Saturn V assembly, tall as a 36-story building, weighing over 6 million pounds, outstrips the wildest fantasies of man. 19 times more powerful than Atlas, it takes off with a thrust equivalent to 160 million horsepower from five engines clustered at its base like the number five on dice. The roar of its liftoff makes the noise of 25,000 stereo sets playing full blast. It vibrates the innards of anybody standing within 3.5 miles of the launch site. In terms of weightlifting, it's as though we had picked a Navy destroyer out of the water and thrown it to the moon. Everything about this newest bird involves superlatives. It stretches the vocabulary of all who attempt to describe it. It's so huge, so complicated, that the Kennedy Space Center had to create a whole new way of handling and carrying it. All sections are stacked on top of each other in a barn 52 stories high, costing $108,700,000. This is the world's largest building, with an interior space so vast that it creates its own weather. If it were not for 10,000 tons of air conditioning, clouds would form inside and it would rain. On August 26th, the whole assembly rolled out through garage doors that are 45 stories high, on a vast tractor called the Crawler, which is as big as a baseball diamond, and whose tread assembly, with each shoe weighing a ton, stands almost twice the height of a man. All this moved almost imperceptibly, at a third of a mile an hour, to Pad A at the moonport, over a special 3.5 mile long road. Altogether, in its every dimension, Saturn V reduces man to a dwarf, except in the one most important dimension. It is man who has conceived, designed, and built all this ingenious immensity.
Now, for cutoff is called in 2 minutes, 34 seconds.
Great, that's not okay.
50 miles downrange, the S2 heading 90.
Now, for the first time in space, the second stage, with its cluster of five J2 engines, is ignited. With a thrust of over 1 million pounds, they hurl the remaining assembly toward the window of insertion into Earth orbit.
Second plane has separated the inner stage surrounding the second stage engine, and the tower has jettisoned. The tower jettisoned around the time for 3 minutes, 20 seconds into the flight.
Soon after, the crews launch escape tower, a system that was eliminated from the Gemini program flights, is shot off.
We've got cut off on the second stage. 8 minutes, 50 seconds, and we have J2 ignition on the third stage.
No!
And Booster says the thrust is okay on the third stage. First thrust, a good thrust, 9 minutes into the flight.
Now, these engines burn out, and the second stage is dumped. Next, the single engine of the third stage, with 225,000 pounds of thrust, takes the spacecraft into its parking orbit more than 114 miles above the Earth, then shuts off to let the spacecraft drift.
11 minutes, 10 seconds, we have a confirmation of cutoff from the Vanguard ship in mid-Atlantic. The S-4B has shut down. Report confirmation came in here at ship in the Mid-Atlantic is we are all go. We are all go.
During this two-orbit breather, a check is made by the flight controllers on the ground at Houston and at the Goddard Space Center in Maryland, which is monitoring through its worldwide tracking stations hundreds of thousands of bits of information on how the equipment is performing. 125 electronic computers are now pouring out this vital information to the controllers. It has already been determined exactly the right moment in all eternity and exactly the right spot in all the universe at which to restart the third stage and shoot out of the confinement of Earth orbit.
Okay. Hydraulics okay?
Go, flight.
Roger, we are at the proper attitude. Roger, attitude. Stand by, everybody. Prado, stand by.
Like the conductor of a vast symphony orchestra,
okay.
One man directs the entire operation.
Keep that off.
With the same soft-spoken Virginia-born gentility that he has shown in his role as flight in dozens of previous launches, Christopher Columbus Kraft, prophetically named for the great Voyager.
J2 ignition.
J2.
It's done. The third stage J2 engine now restarts. The first time this operation has been tested in space. It will thrust the spacecraft out to a 10,696-mile peak. 17 minutes later, there is an added boost from a 16-second burst of the engine in the Apollo service module, which drives the spacecraft out another 538 miles.
Yeah. Do you want me to go through you for release of these stations? As you see fit.
Roger, fine.
And as you release them, tell them it was a good job.
Roger, fine.
We still have a mission to fly, but so far we're on our way to third base.
Roger that.
What is now shooting through space are the two remaining elements of the Apollo space vehicle. These are the cone-shaped command module, in which one day three astronauts will ride, and attached behind the heat shield, the cylindrical service module, with its own fuel tanks and engine capable of restarting 36 times.
SPS on flight.
If this engine were to burn another 19 seconds and its direction were adjusted, the craft would be going to the moon. But enough for one test. As the giant curve reaches 11,234 miles, the vehicle, pulled by gravity, begins to turn back toward the Earth. Finally, on the homeward voyage, the engine is restarted to help slam it faster earthward. Now, just before re-entry into the Earth's atmosphere, the command module separates from the service module. Alone, the unmanned Apollo cone races home. The added speed of the service engine, plus the increased pull of gravity, have driven it up to a speed of 25,000 miles per hour, subjecting the new heat shield to a temperature of 5,000 degrees, its most severe test. Home again, after 8 hours, 36 minutes, and 54 seconds. A 10.5-foot high section of the 363-foot structure that blasted off. It lands within 6 miles of the aircraft carrier Bennington, its skin scorched and blackened by the heat of its return, but everything inside undamaged and undisturbed, as would have been the crew had there been one. But Apollo 4 has been an unmanned test, carrying only the usual black boxes inside to simulate flesh and blood. Meanwhile, Russia also claims a new space achievement, the automatic rendezvous, docking, and separation of two unmanned Earth satellites, all directed from Earth by sophisticated computers. Moscow describes the operation as a step toward creating big scientific space stations in orbit. This starts a new round in the guessing game. Some Western scientists speculate that Russia may be planning to shoot for the moon from such a space platform. Another rumor has it that she's already building a launch vehicle even more powerful than our own Saturn V. The new year sends a troubled world looking for remedies in all directions. Even the rich and famous Beatles, searching for peace of mind, take off for India to study transcendental meditation with a high-priced guru. Everywhere there is heavy and continued consumption of pot. On the stage, nudity becomes popular. On the university campuses, students sit in to protest the existing order. And on television, Rowan and Martin do the same with their laugh-in.
We have ignition. We have liftoff.
In space, we take a modest step forward with Apollo 5, an unmanned test of the lunar module, K-1. carried into orbit by a Saturn 1B. At the front of the second stage, panels open as planned to release the moon bug for a partially successful test of the engine, which will be used to slow its descent to a lunar landing. But politics, not space, now dominates the scene in this presidential year, with Romney, Rockefeller, Nixon, and Reagan leading among the Republicans. As continued escalation of the Vietnam War brings only continued stalemate and heavier casualties, a soft-spoken U.S. Senator from Minnesota, Eugene McCarthy, suddenly talks up.
My decision to challenge the president's position and the administration's position has been strengthened by recent announcements out of the administration. The evident intention to escalate and to intensify the war in Vietnam, and on the other hand, the absence of any positive indications or suggestions for a compromise or for a negotiated political settlement.
He challenges President Johnson in the Democratic primary in New Hampshire and shows astonishing strength. At once, the junior senator from New York State, Robert Kennedy, throws his hat into the ring. Then suddenly, President Johnson declares,
"With American sons in the field far away, with America's future under challenge right here at home, with our hopes and the world's hopes for peace and the balance every day, I do not believe that I should devote an hour or a day of my time to any personal partisan causes or to any duties other than the awesome duties of this office, the presidency of your country. Accordingly, I shall not seek and I will not accept the nomination of my party for another term as your president."
Death suddenly brings the space race back into the picture as Radio Moscow announces that cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin, the first man, had been killed on March 27th while test flying a new plane. And with him, Colonel Vladimir Suryogin, chief of the cosmonaut detachment. Previously, cosmonaut Vladimir Komarov was killed when his new spacecraft, Soyuz 1, tangled in its own parachute shrouds while landing after a successful flight.
Mark, 7 minutes, 45 seconds. We have a preliminary report of the loss of two engines. This would be engines 2 and 3.
April 4th. 5 months after the brilliant first test of the unmanned Saturn V, we take a big, expensive step backward in an attempt to repeat. This time, hoping to push the unmanned Apollo spacecraft some 14,000 miles out. But two of the second stage engines shut off prematurely as the Big Bird gets into orbit. And next, the third stage engine fails to reignite and kick the spacecraft out of parking orbit toward its far out goal. The cost? $90 million. By evening the same day, America suffers a far greater loss.
I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today.
Dr. Martin Luther King, the American Gandhi, leader of the nonviolent struggle for civil rights, is murdered by a sniper while chatting in the sunset on the balcony of a Memphis motel. The death of this winner of the Nobel Peace Prize sets off new ghetto violence. Senator Robert Kennedy, who lost a brother to such a sniper, leads the demand for stricter gun control. 2 months later,
the senator is on the ground. He's bleeding profusely from apparently, clear back. Apparently, the senator has been shot.
Robert Kennedy loses his own life to an assassin. Politics and stage. Space? It's now getting on to 2 years since we last launched a manned vehicle. We take as a matter of course satellite weather reports every night on the 11 o'clock news and even the live TV transmission via satellite from Asia and Europe. There's no public excitement in the tedious, grueling 18 hours a day training program that is readying crews of three for the manned Apollo flights. With Vietnam now costing $25 billion a year, The national budget is amputated everywhere else. The space program is reduced to where it will just cover a moon landing and little beyond. Though the late President Kennedy warned on that very day in 1961 when he first set our lunar goal,
let it be clear that I am asking the Congress and the country to accept a firm commitment to a new course of action, a course which will last for many years and carry very heavy costs. If we are to go only halfway or reduce our sights in the face of difficulty, in my judgment, it would be better not to go at all, because it is a heavy burden. And there is no sense in agreeing or desiring that the United States take an affirmative position in outer space unless we are prepared to do the work and bear the burdens to make it successful. If we are not, we should decide today and this year.
Summer, the Republicans, at a Unity and Harmony convention in Miami Beach, pick a familiar figure as their candidate for president.
Richard M. Nixon.
In sharp contrast, Vice President Hubert H. Humphrey wins the Democratic nomination at a fierce convention in Chicago that leaves his party torn and bleeding. And George Corley Wallace of Alabama declares as the law and order candidate of a third party. Radio Moscow suddenly triggers the worrisome guessing game anew by announcing that the Soviet spacecraft Zond 5 has splashed down in the Indian Ocean on September 21st after an unmanned flight in which it whipped around the moon, though without entering moon orbit. At Cape Kennedy, Wally Schirra, the nerveless veteran of superb Mercury and Gemini flights, Mr. Cool himself, suddenly finds himself at age 45 feeling a little old and tired. The 18-hour-a-day grind, the separation from his family, have taken out all the fun. Yes, he's having a ball. What lifted Wally's spirit so dramatically is the brilliant launch on October 11th of Apollo 7 atop the well-proven Saturn 1B. It's our first manned flight since Gus Grissom and his crew were killed in the fire on the same launch pad 21 months ago. Another serious failure would have all but erased hope of landing an American on the moon by the end of 1970.
About 24 hours after liftoff, we'll commence a sequence of exercises aimed at doing a rendezvous with the S-4B booster that we're separated from about 3 hours after liftoff.
In the middle seat, to the right of Wally, and serving as navigator on his first flight, Air Force Major Don Eisley, who won his place in the spacecraft by applying over and over for astronaut training until he got an answer of yes.
One of the prime requisites of this flight is to come back with a feeling that all of the spacecraft systems are capable of supporting a flight of duration that would take you to the
moon. That's Walt Cunningham, former Marine pilot and also a first-timer. On this flight, his job is to test out every system in the brand new Apollo spacecraft.
We've been monitoring Schirra's heart rate because that's the only physical parameter we have coming through, and it at launch and through the early stages ran about 90 to 92 beats.
Can you imagine that?
4 minutes, 50 seconds into the flight.
He's such a cool son of a gun.
15 hours into the flight, Wally Schirra, hero of so many space achievements, becomes the first man in space to develop a cold.
I have a nose cold. I've probably gone through about 8 or 9 Kleenex with some pretty good flows. I've taken 2 aspirin, and I'm wondering if there's anything else I can take.
Dr. Chuck Berry prescribes decongestant pills for Wally, and also his 2 shipmates, who have soon come to share his cold. Next, Wally's first public flash of temper. For weeks before the flight, he resisted a pet NASA plan for a live telecast airborne from the spacecraft. Now, when asked to prepare for the telecast, Shirah replies,
"You've added a urine water dump, and we have a new vehicle up here. And I'm saying at this point, TV will be delayed without any further discussion until after the rendezvous."
2 days later, with most of their work accomplished, the crew puts on a Wally, Walt, and Don TV show in which they flash before the camera previously prepared cue cards, like, "From the lovely Apollo room, high atop everything," and,
"Okay, what's the next one? A little closer, Wally. Keep those cards and letters coming in, folks. It's loud and clear."
The first light moments on the world scene in the year 1968. On the fifth day, Shirah evens an old score with Slayton. In 1962, during Wally's Mercury flight, Deke put Wally on the spot by publicly facing him with a turtle routine, to which Shirah manfully gave the required answer. Now the tables are turned.
"Just a minute, Wally, let's see. Oh, it's a little message to Deke Slayton."
"That's right.
Looks like it says, are you a turtle, Deke Slayton?"
"That's right."
Slayton replies, but on a closed circuit. As the days grind on, there are further sparks of irritation from space. NASA doctors blame the head colds, long confinement, the monotony of an almost perfect flight. Paul Haney, noting that the crew has gone unshaven, offers another theory.
"Something happens to a guy who grows a beard. The next thing he starts to protest."
Finally, after 163 turns about the Earth and almost 11 days in space, Apollo 7 splashes down in the Atlantic, 230 miles south of Bermuda. From Lieutenant General Sam Phillips, Apollo Program Director, comes the appraisal.
"Apollo 7 goes in my book as a perfect mission. In my experience, this is the first space operation that's accomplished more than 100% of its pre-planned objectives. Our official count is that we accomplished 101% of our intended objectives. I conclude by saying that the Apollo program is now in the manned flight phase, which many of us have been working some years to accomplish, that we can see the lunar landing, and I have every confidence myself that the progress of our missions will let us accomplish that by the end of next year."
In 260 hours and 8 minutes aloft, the crew of Apollo 7 compiled more man hours in space than all the manned Russian flights combined. Most of all, they've proved that Apollo's structure, control, navigation, communications, and life support systems are completely spaceworthy. October 26th, 4 days after the homecoming of Apollo 7, the Soviets make another baffling launch of their own from their Baikonur Cosmodrome on the south central plains of Asian Russia. Colonel Georgi T. Beregovoy goes up in spacecraft Soyuz 3 to perform rendezvous maneuvers with a previously orbiting and unmanned Soyuz 2. Twice, the two ships are guided toward each other, automatically and manually, but reportedly no closer than 650 feet, with no attempt at docking. A Soviet commentator declares that the eventual aim is to link in space several craft that would form an orbiting laboratory. So again, American spacemen ask, what are the Russians really up to? In the next 10 days, a presidential campaign that has been saturated with surprises produces yet two more. On Thursday, October 31st, after months of stalemated peace talks in Paris between representatives of the U.S. and North Vietnam, President Johnson, in a 20-minute TV talk, announces,
"I have now ordered that all air, naval, and artillery bombardment of North Vietnam cease as of 8 a.m. Washington time Friday morning. I have reached this decision on the basis of the developments in the Paris talks, and I have reached it in the belief that this action can lead to progress toward a peaceful settlement of the Vietnamese war."
Some Republicans denounced the move as a political trick to bolster the long sagging campaign of Hubert Humphrey. True or not, the election winds up as an all-night horse race, Not until well into the next morning can the winner be determined with absolute certainty. Richard Nixon, by a nose and an eyelash, in one of the most remarkable political comebacks in U.S. history. Then, early in the morning of the day before Christmas, 1968, from 230,000 miles out in space, comes a radio message that only days before was still considered impossible by most people on Earth. The voice of Captain Jim Lovell, who on two Gemini flights logged 7 million miles and became the most traveled man in history. Speaking now for the three-man crew of Apollo 8. With those plain words, he informs the world that Apollo 8 has accomplished the mind-shaking feat of entering the orbit of the moon and is flying an elliptical course that swoops as low as 60.5 miles from that dead and awesome surface. Later, in a telecast to all the world, the crew give us the reactions of Earthmen taking the first close-up look at the moon in the 4 or 5 billion years since it was created. First, the spacecraft commander, Frank Borman.
The moon is a different thing to each one of us. I think that each one carries his own impressions of what he's seen today. I know my own impression is that it's a vast, lonely, forbidding type existence or expanse of nothing. It looks rather like clouds and clouds of pumice stone. And it certainly would not appear to be a very inviting place to live or work. Jim, what have you thought most about?
Well, Frank, my thoughts were very similar. The vast loneliness up here on the moon is awe-inspiring, and it makes you realize just what you have back there on Earth. The Earth from here is a grand oasis of the big vastness of space.
Bill, what do you think?
Bill is Air Force Major William Anders, third man in the spacecraft, an expert on radiation, whose special assignment is to study possible harm from expected solar flares.
I think the thing that impressed me the most were the lunar sunrises and sunsets. These in particular bring out the stark nature of the terrain, and the long shadows really bring out the relief that is here and hard to see in this very bright surface that we're going over right now.
Frank Borman, a lay reader of the Episcopal Church, says a prayer which he addresses to people everywhere.
Give us, O God, the vision which can see thy love in the world in spite of human failure. Give us the faith to trust the goodness in spite of our ignorance and weakness. Give us the knowledge that we may continue to pray with understanding hearts. And show us what each one of us can do to set forward the coming of the day of universal peace. Amen.
Amen.
I was supposed to lay read tonight, and I couldn't quite make it.
Right, Judge. I think they understand.
Apollo 8 was undertaken against 100 warnings of danger. At every press conference, someone asked if the astronauts would carry suicide pills. The answer each time was a flat no. The Apollo 8 crew simply did not consider this a suicide mission. As Frank Borman put it,
when you look at the overall mission, you come away with a realization that as any of these missions go, any of the lunar missions go, it's a conservative mission. Now, I don't believe in the trite saying that, you're accepting more risk by driving on a freeway or something like that. As far as I'm concerned, that's nonsense. But the business is risky, and I think we've accepted a minimal amount of unknowns on this flight. I look at it as something like a combat tour in Vietnam.
Final reports coming from Frank Borman at this time. Final look at the switch list aboard the spacecraft.
35 seconds and counting. We'll lead
now, finally, on December 21st, at Launch Pad 39A, the three-man crew took their places atop a Saturn V rocket.
Well, it's zero. We just passed the 25-second mark in the count.
A newspaper report noted that Borman, Lovell, and Anders, though they have fathered 11 children among them, were themselves each an only child. And, continued the report, psychologists have found that only children are usually better achievers, better able to face challenges and climb the ladder of success.
4, 3, 2, 1, 0. We have liftoff. Liftoff at 7:51.
Liftoff, the clock is running.
Roger, clock.
We're all a pitch program.
Roger.
How do you hear, Houston?
Loud and clear.
On the second Earth orbit, a five-minute burn of the third stage engine whips up speed from 17,400 miles an hour to a new record 24,200.
Ignition. Roger, ignition.
Roger.
Fast enough to hurl the spacecraft out of the Earth's gravitational clutch and inject it into a translunar path toward the moon.
Flight, oh, flight. Go, flight. You look okay?
We look good.
Okay.
Apollo 8 is cutting across space to catch the moon. Not at the point where it now is, but where it will reach 3 days hence. Leading the moon, as a hunter aims ahead of a flying duck.
We see the Earth now.
After Apollo 8 has passed the previous distance record of 853 miles set by Gemini 11, the craft is turned so that the astronauts can see the Earth they have left. Jim Lovell reports.
Beautiful view of Florida now. We can see the Cape just the point.
Roger.
And at the same time, we can see Africa. West Africa is beautiful. I can also see Gibraltar at the same time I'm looking at Florida.
Sounds good. Get a picture of it. What window are you looking at?
The center window. I can see the entire Earth now out of the center window. I can see Florida, Cuba, Central America, the whole northern half of Central America, in fact, all the way down through Argentina and down through Chile.
You picked a good day for it.
About a quarter of the way along the translunar path, the astronauts make a slight mid-course correction by firing the service module engine for a couple of seconds. A tweaking burn, as the engineers call it.
Apollo 8, this is Houston, all right?
Go ahead, Houston, I agree.
Now, Roger, we're reading you loud and clear. We're on a private loop now, and we'd like to get some amplifying details on your medical problem. Could
next day, December 22nd, for all the medical precautions that were taken in advance of the flight, Frank Borman comes down with violent symptoms, vomiting, diarrhea, chills, and headache. Lovell and Anders are hit with only a slight case of the same. Dr. Chuck Berry of NASA gets on the radio for the most distant medical diagnosis and treatment ever made. At 120,000 miles, he decides it's 24-hour flu for Borman, milder versions for the others.
Frank, this is Chuck. Did you read that you ought to take the Lomotil and the Mirazine can be used if you do get nauseated, any one of the three of you?
Okay, thank you.
The first telecast has been scheduled for this day. Shots of the Earth and the astronauts at work. Despite illness, the show goes on, directed by Frank Borman.
Okay, we're rolling around to a good view of the Earth. And as soon as we get to the good view of the Earth, we'll stop and let you look out the window at the scene we see.
And with this, as if looking at its own face in a mirror, the Earth glimpses a glowing ball in space that is like a brighter moon, and almost like a sun. Next day, Monday, December 23rd, looking back at the Earth from over 175,000 miles, Jim Lovell speculates.
Ourselves as seen from 180,000 miles out in space.
Mike, what I keep imagining is if I'm some lonely traveler from another planet, what do I think about the Earth from this altitude, whether I think it'd be inhabited or not?
Don't see anybody waiting, is that what you're saying?
Now, I'm just kind of curious whether I would land on the blue or the brown part of the Earth.
To which Frank replies,
you better hope we land in the blue part.
So are we, babe.
Jim is always for land landing.
An hour later, they reach a magical point, 200,000 miles out from Earth, where the moon's gravity exceeds the Earth's. In this moment, they become the first men in all time who are literally out of this world. Hour by hour, minute by minute, the pre-scheduled time approaches for lunar orbit insertion. Now, on December 24th, in the dark before the Texas dawn, 68 hours and 4 minutes from the time of launch at Cape Kennedy, a message goes from Jerry Carr, an astronaut trainee serving as CAPCOM.
Apollo 8, this is Houston at 6804, your go for LOI.
Frank Borman replies.
Okay, Apollo 8 is go.
You're riding the best bird we can find, over.
Thank you.
Now, 3,125 miles from the moon, Apollo 8 goes into a gentle curve toward the backside of the moon, pulled faster and faster now by the force of lunar gravity. 54 minutes later, it goes behind the moon. There, its radio communication with Earth will be blocked for 45 minutes by loss of signal. Just before the tense silence is to start, the official commentator in Houston, John McLeish, remarks,
2 minutes, 50 seconds away from time of LOS now. Our distance away from the moon, 460 nautical miles. Velocity, 7417 feet per second. Here in mission control, we're standing by. There's certainly a great deal of anxiety at this moment.
A last message for the moment from Jerry Carr.
Apollo 8 Houston, 1 minute to LOS, all systems go. Roger, safe journey, guys.
Bill Anders.
Thanks a lot, Chris. We'll see you on the other side.
Apollo 8, 10 seconds to go. You're go all the way.
Roger.
For the next 45 minutes, complete blackout. No one on Earth can know if the engine is fired on schedule or burned long enough to put the craft in orbit. Too short a burn could crash Apollo 8 into the moon. The longest 45 minutes in the universe. Then finally, from Houston.
Apollo Control, Houston. We're looking at engine data, and it looks good. Tank pressures look good. We have not talked yet with the crew, but we're standing by. We've got it. We've got it. Apollo 8 now in lunar orbit. There's a cheer in this room. This is Apollo Control Houston. Switching now to the voice of Jim Lovell.
By 60.5. Good to hear your voice.
Jim Lovell, followed by wild cheering in Houston Control in a Christmas Eve unlike any since the child's birth in a manger 1,968 years ago. For in this moment, returning from their first circle of the moon, Frank Borman, Jim Lovell, and Bill Anders have joined the ranks of the great explorers of history.
The moon is essentially gray. No color.
Again, they fire the engine to change their course to a smooth, even, circular orbit 70 miles above the moon. In all, they circle it 10 times over a period of some 21 hours, beaming back pictures of what they describe as a vast, forbidding expanse of nothing. They name craters for the 8 fellow astronauts who have died. On the 9th orbit, as they finish their third telecast, Bill Anders solemnly announces,
we are now approaching lunar sunrise, and for all the people back on Earth, the crew of Apollo 8 has a message that we would like to send to you.
With that, the three men begin reading the opening verses of the book of Genesis, starting with Bill Anders.
In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep.
and the gathering together of the water.
The telecast closes with Frank Borman signing off.
God saw that it was good. And from the crew of Apollo 8, we close with good night, good luck, a Merry Christmas, and God bless all of you on the good earth.
An hour into Christmas Day, the SPS engine is scheduled to be fired and thrust Apollo 8 out of lunar orbit and back toward Earth. This is to take place on the dark side of the moon, where radio signals are blacked out. The world waits 37 minutes.
Please inform there is a Santa Claus.
That message from Jim Lovell as the spacecraft heads back toward Earth. Under the three main parachutes, Apollo 8 floats down into the Pacific south of Hawaii. 6 days and 3 hours from the moment of launch. With Apollo 8, a dark year ends in radiance. We learn that our troubled planet, observed from a distance, gives out a lovely earthshine. Poet Archibald MacLeish sees mankind as riders on the earth together, brothers on that bright loveliness in the eternal cold. The intelligent adventurousness of the moonshot, the calm daring of the crew, the perfection of the equipment, the dazzling precision of the entire operation. All this suddenly reawakens mankind to an appreciation of its best possibilities.